Good afternoon. My name is Randa Hamadeh. I'm the head of the primary healthcare department at the Ministry of Public Health in Lebanon. I'm now move you from the experiments on rats, on mice, on horses, to see what's going on really in one of the region of the world in the Middle East regarding polio. And when I'm saying polio now, I'm talking about the polio virus and about the oral polio vaccine, because long time many countries stopped using the oral polio vaccine. So now we're back in the Middle East to face an outbreak of polio, and this is why I'm here today, in order to think with you and in order to let you know that you are mistaken if anybody of us would think that we are away and we are really far away from the outbreak, because if we have one child in the world with polio, so the whole world is really in danger. So let's see what's going on in the Middle East, and accordingly you will judge. I'll talk about the history of polio, production of vaccine, global situation, Middle East outbreak, response, conclusion, and way forward. If you can remember with me the history of polio, as it peaked in 1952, more than 21,000 Americans suffered paralyzed polio, 3,000 died from it. We can't see in this slide except iron lung, patient inside the machine for respiration, could do little except looking up at a mirror reflecting the room behind. And if you can recall also that polio and like all diseases, they don't differentiate between poor or rich, between young or old, between developed and developing countries. Franklin Roosevelt, the 32nd president of the United States, suffered from a suspected polio in 1921 at age of 39. Until 12 April 1955, and thanks to those two heroes, Salk and Sabin, where the production of the Salk vaccine works, but was largely replaced by the Sabin vaccine in early 1960s, which is the oral polio vaccine we are all using now. Global situation showed that in 1988, the whole world was infected, except two regions that are Australia and north of America. By the use of trivalent OPV, the picture changed completely in 2006, and the virus was kicked out of the whole globe except Afghanistan and Pakistan, India and Nigeria. Polio teams celebrate the few steps at that time to eradicating polio. Unfortunately, the virus was transmitted again from India to reinfect Horn of Africa due to low routine vaccination coverage and no supplementary immunization days. And this turned out to have some endemic countries re-establishing, also proven to have polio again, and the importation belt between different countries until we reached 2014, and here we have the picture again, where we have three endemic countries and four reinfected countries that are Iraq, Syria, Somalia, and Kenya. Here comes the commitment of WHO, UNICEF, and the international organization. So they said, although virus re-established a new circulation, but all stakeholders agreed to continue supporting polio eradication programs. And accordingly, the World Health Assembly in 2012 declares polio virus eradication as a programmatic emergency for global public health. And in 2013, they declared it as global emergency. They endorsed endgame strategic plan. So now the question comes, why Middle East has been infected by polio virus? Did the outbreak in the Middle East cease, and what is the future plan for the Middle East regarding polio? To answer first about why Middle East, unrest changed the community behavior and priorities. The question during unrest and instability is looking for the casualty, emergency, treatment, and not prevention. No one will think about immunity, but people fight to survive. Later, people would move internally, would start to displace from places of war to places of more stability, and this displacement would maybe cause some less immunity in the whole environment where they are living. Accordingly, the immunity level will be reduced, but still the community at this stage is not at risk because there is no virus. When conflict continues, the borders will not be under control. Many doors would be open. And now it is the chance for the outsiders to come and penetrate the community. Then virus will come in low immunity level. So here we see that the virus is coming to the low immunity level, and the result would be that polio virus transmitted from infected country to Syria. We had 36 polio cases in Syria, which is a country at bordering Lebanon. Polio virus transmitted from Syria to Iraq, where they had 2 polio cases. Environmental samples showed positive polio virus in sewage in Egypt, Palestine, Gaza, and West Bank. And this is too dangerous. This slide shows how the virus transmitted from far place with population movement. When population started to move, so the virus started to move with the population to another area. It also shows that there is another challenge in the polio program, other than endemic countries, which is re-establishing virus recirculation. Why Syria was this vulnerable? Because if you can see in this slide that through 2009, when the war started in Syria, the routine immunization coverage started to go down. Then they reached the 52% coverage in 2012. And with all the factors I talked about, the displacement, internal displacement, the importation, the doors open, the importation, penetration of virus, this is what happened actually in Syria. In addition to that, we see that the surveillance system was not sensitive enough to detect the AFP cases. Where polio is one of them, then patients paralyzed by the virus were not detected by the system, then the virus spread peacefully. So routine immunization was low, AFP cases was not detected as it should, and in addition to missing many paralyzed children, the number of children picked by the system are not handled properly. The system did not give a chance to the lab to isolate the virus from inadequate stools collected. So we have 3 main factors, indicators, helping them or making the situation happen as it is. In this slide, I want to let you be reminded that WHO and governments, though they worked hard, but they should also be reminded that the nightmare of Tajikistan outbreak, when the polio virus killed 60% out of 460 confirmed cases, suffered paralytic polio. Not only that, the virus also spread up to Moscow. If we see up Moscow, the virus spread up to Moscow. It was a lesson learned to the polio team, and an immediate action have been taken to control the outbreak in Syria, because in Syria we have the displacement from Syria to the surrounding countries. We have a huge number of displaced persons going out, and the biggest number was to Lebanon, where we have now around 2,200,000 displaced Syrians in the country. For that reason, all Middle East countries were identified at risk. All ministers, health ministers, met to discuss and take an immediate action and look for available resources and work together to solve the problem and to contain it more than solve it. a polio hub in the center of the battle to be very close and move fast wherever needed, most experienced people and experts in polio from all over the world were transferred to support the Middle East in this crisis, donor advocacy and fund allocated, and they developed a strategic plan. The goal of the strategic plan was to interrupt polio in Syria and to prevent polio in surrounding countries. So we have one goal with different axes. The first axis for this was a technical strategy to control the outbreak, where we had to conduct several supplementary immunization activities in Egypt, Iraq, Jordan, Lebanon, Syria, Turkey, and Palestine. So we had conducted 38 SIAs, have been conducted, as I said, across the region, targeting approximately 25 million children with multiple doses. The second axe was in the technical strategy, the use of the bivalent OPV, because the trivalent OPV was used in the Middle East. Now we introduced the 1 and the 3 OPV, which is most efficient for such crisis in the Middle East. So for the first time, as it has higher seroconversion rate, which is 80% compared to 53% for the OPV, TOPV, trivalent OPV. A third also axe was short interval between different SIAs, where 98% seroconversion rate when using BOPV in short interval. Instead of doing the first campaign now and after 1 month you do the second, we use the BOPV now and in 2 weeks' time we do the second, so we will have higher seroconversion rate, which is reach 98%. What were the outcomes? The virus stopped in Syria, as we can see from this slide, and last case reported 7 months ago, which is good enough. The last case in Iraq was reported 4 months ago, also, which is not bad. But do you think that this is the end of the outbreak, or the outbreak would stop, finish, and should we relax after that? What do you think? Should we relax after having all of this? I think no. We should continue working. The whole world should continue working with us because it's a virus that might be transmitted easily from one place to another and from one continent to another. So we still have zero AFP cases, though they improved in vaccination in SIAs, but we still have zero dose AFP cases that are reported from Syria and Iraq. That means vaccination team could not reach some places where there are conflicts, still conflict going on, and there are children deprived of anything, especially vaccines. In quarter two and quarter three of 2014, after all these campaigns, this slide showed zero dose AFP, which is not logical, because as you might know, that we should report as a country 2 cases per 100,000 population to define our system to be a good system in terms of acute flaccid paralysis. So they are still reporting zero cases. This also verify for us that there are places that they are not reachable and there are vulnerable people living in those places. What would be the conclusion? The response of the polio outbreak in the Middle East is satisfactory, but security situation in Syria and Iraq is not good and other countries looks volatile. There are areas in Syria and Iraq that are blind. Immunity and surveillance are questionable. Population movement continues between countries. Neighbor communities are tired due to frequent SIAs. People are becoming, and parents are becoming really tired and asking, why you're giving my child this much of drops of the polio. So what are the way forward? We have insecure areas. In the insecure areas, we should continue monitoring the opportunity to vaccinate the children, then introduce supplementary immunization activities, permanent vaccination teams at the exit and entry of those insecure areas, they should be there. For the secure areas, contingency mop-up plan to cover immediately any area has received people from insecure or infected area, maintain high-level commitment and coordination between different partners and different countries. For both secure and insecure areas, we select professional PCM monitors so as to ensure quality of vaccination, strengthen routine EPI, combined IPV with OPV, because as you might know that the IPV is for the individual immunity and the OPV is for the mass immunity. Strengthened surveillance system too is a must. Here, this slide shows that last few kilometers of the marathon are the most difficult ones. It needs meticulous analysis, risk prediction, proactive work ahead of the virus and not behind it. The world invested billions of dollars that we should not lose them now. The children of the Middle East thank all of you to continue efforts to save the world. And my acknowledgement go to UNICEF, WHO, and the European Union for their support of the polio initiative in the Middle East and in the world. Thank you.
Thank you for a wonderful talk. I think that emphasizes why we do vaccine research, but also tells us even when we have effective vaccines, we still have a big issue in making sure that they're delivered to everyone at need. So I think it's really a great insight into what's happening still with polio, and we still haven't defeated it.
Yeah.
Any questions?
Yes, please.
Most problems now are in Pakistan. Do you have any view on that topic, that area?
Yeah, as I said, that Pakistan is still an endemic country, but now the danger is in other countries, because in Pakistan, WHO is now moving too many experts and people to contain the disease there. But what's going on, and they know the tricks of it, but what's going on in the Middle East, especially in Syria, is very dangerous because you don't know who is with the regime and who is against the regime, so that you cannot control anything in the field. So if you have a reported figure saying that we covered 95% of the children, you should ask, is it the regime figure or the anti-regime figure? Because those people cannot, nor the regime could reach the anti-regime areas, nor the other way. So it's really difficult. That's why in our country, in Lebanon, what we are doing is that we're placing at the borderline with Lebanon, by the way, is polio-free since 14 years now. And we want to keep this accomplishment. That's why we are working hard in terms of SIAs, in terms of the AFP, because we are working too hard on those initiatives. In addition to that, we are putting on the borderline areas with Syria vaccination point. No one person is allowed to enter or go from the country unless taking two drops of OPV, regardless of previous doses. And also at the airport, we do the same. So the problem now is in Syria, because there are the issue is very sensitive, it's very critical. You have so many vulnerable people and vulnerable areas, so you have to contain it in a way that you don't spread the virus all around the countries.
Thank you very much.
It's a real pleasure.